In 355, Androtion was appointed to head a squad of police empowered to search for hidden income, collect arrears, and imprison tax evaders. Houses were entered, goods were seized, men were thrown into jail. But the wealth still hid itself or melted away. Isocrates, old and rich and furious at being saddled with a liturgy, complained in 353, "When I was a boy, wealth was regarded as a thing so secure as well as admirable that almost everyone affected to own more property than he actually possessed. Now a man has to be ready to defend himself against being rich as if it were the worst of crimes." In other cities, the process of decentralizing wealth was not so legal. The debtors of Mytilene massacred their creditors en masse and excused themselves on the ground that they were hungry. The Democrats of Argos in 370 suddenly fell upon the rich, killed 1,200 of them, and confiscated their property. The moneyed families of otherwise hostile states leagued themselves secretly for mutual aid against popular revolts. The middle classes, as well as the rich, began to distrust democracy as empowered envy, and the poor began to distrust it as a sham equality of votes stultified by a gaping inequality of wealth. The increasing bitterness of the class war left Greece internally as well as internationally divided when Philip pounced down upon it, and many rich men in the Greek cities welcomed his coming as the alternative to revolution. Moral disorder accompanied the growth of luxury and the enlightenment of the mind. The masses cherished their superstitions and clung to their myths. The gods of Olympus were dying, but new ones were being born. Exotic divinities like Isis and Ammon, Atis and Bendis, Cybele and Adonis were imported from Egypt or Asia, and the spread of Orphism brought fresh devotees to Dionysus every day. The rising and half-alien bourgeoisie of Athens, trained to practical calculation rather than to mystic feeling, had little use for the traditional faith. The patron gods of the city won from them only a formal reverence and no longer inspired them with moral scruples or devotion to the state. Philosophy struggled to find in civic loyalty and a natural ethic some substitute for divine commandments and a surveillant deity, but few citizens cared to live with the simplicity of Socrates or the magnanimity of Aristotle's great-minded man. As the state religion lost its hold upon the educated classes, the individual freed himself more and more from the old moral restraints, the son from parental authority, the male from marriage, the woman from motherhood, the citizen from political responsibility. Doubtless Aristophanes exaggerated these developments, and though Plato, Xenophon, and Isocrates agreed with him, they were all conservatives who might be relied upon to tremble at any doings of the growing generation. The morals of war improved in the 4th century, and a wave of Enlightenment humanitarianism followed the teachings of Euripides and Socrates and the example of Agesilaus. But sexual and political morality continued to decline. Bachelors and courtesans increased in fashionable cooperation, and free unions gained ground on legal marriage. "Is not a concubine more desirable than a wife?" asks a character in a 4th century comedy. "The one has on her side the law that compels you to retain her, no matter how displeasing she may be. The other knows that she must hold a man by behaving well, or else look for another." So Praxiteles and then Hyperides lived with Phryne, Aristippus with Lais, Stilpo with Nicarete, Lysias with Metanira, the austere Isocrates with Legiscium. "The young men," says Theopompus with a moralist's exaggeration, "spent all their time among flute girls and courtesans. Those who were a little older devoted themselves to gambling and profligacy, and the whole people spent more on public banquets and entertainments than on the provision necessary for the well-being of the state." The voluntary limitation of the family was the order of the day, whether by contraception, by abortion, or by infanticide. Aristotle notes that some women prevent conception by anointing that part of the womb upon which the seed falls with oil of cedar, or ointment of lead or frankincense commingled with olive oil. The old families were dying out. They existed, said Isocrates, only in their tombs. The lower classes were multiplying, but the citizen class in Attica had fallen from 43,000 in 431 to 22,000 in 400 and 21,000 in 313. The supply of citizens for military service suffered a corresponding decrease, partly from the dysgenic carnage of war, partly from the reduced number of those who had a property stake in the state, partly from unwillingness to serve. The life of comfort and domesticity, of business and scholarship, had replaced the Periclean life of exercise, martial discipline, and public office. Athletics were professionalized. The citizens who in the 6th century had crowded the palestra and the gymnasium were now content to exert themselves vicariously by witnessing professional exhibitions. Young men received some grounding, as epaboy, in the art of war, but adults found 100 ways of escaping military service. War itself had become professionalized by technical complications and required the full time of specially trained men. Citizen soldiers had to be replaced with mercenaries, an omen that the leadership of Greece must soon pass from statesmen to warriors. While Plato talked of philosopher kings, soldier kings were growing up under his nose. Greek mercenaries sold themselves impartially to Greek or barbarian generals and fought as often against Greece as for her. The Persian armies that Alexander faced were full of Greeks. Soldiers shed their blood now not for a fatherland, but for the best paymaster that they could find. Making honorable exceptions for the archonship of Euclides in 403 and the financial administration of Lycurgus from 338 to 326, the political corruption and turbulence that had followed the death of Pericles continued during the 4th century. According to the law, bribery was punished with death. According to Isocrates, it was rewarded with military and political preferment. Persia had no difficulty in bribing the Greek politicians to make war upon other Greek states or upon Macedon. At last, even Demosthenes illustrated the morals of his time. He was one of the noblest of one of the lowest groups in Athens, the rhetors, or hired orators, who in this century became professional lawyers and politicians. Some of these men, like Lycurgus, were reasonably honest. Some of them, like Hyperides, were gallant. Most of them were no better than they had to be. If we may take Aristotle's word for it, many of them specialized in invalidating wills. Several of them laid up great fortunes through political opportunism and reckless demagogy. The rhetors divided into parties and tore the air with their campaigns. Each party organized committees, invented catchwords, appointed agents, and raised funds. Those who paid the expenses of all this frankly confessed that they expected to reimburse themselves doubly. As politics grew more intense, patriotism waned. The bitterness of faction absorbed public energy and devotion and left little for the city. The constitution of Cleisthenes and the individualism of commerce and philosophy had weakened the family and liberated the individual. Now the free individual, as if to avenge the family, turned around and destroyed the state. In or near 400, the triumphant Democrats, to ensure the presence of the poorer citizens at the ecclesia, and thereby to prevent its domination by the propertied classes, extended state payment to attendance at the assembly. At first, each citizen received an obol, or 17 cents. As the cost of living rose, this was increased to 2 obols, then to 3, until in Aristotle's time it stood at a drachma, or $1, per day. It was a reasonable arrangement, for the ordinary citizen, towards the end of the 4th century, earned a drachma and a half for a day's work. He could not be expected to leave his employment without some recompense. The plan soon gave the poor a majority in the assembly. More and more the well-to-do, despairing of victory, stayed home. It was of no use that a revision of the Constitution in 403 confined the power of legislation to a body of 5 nomothetai, or lawmakers, selected from the citizens chosen by lot for jury service. This new group also inclined to the side of the commons, and its interposition lowered the prestige and authority of the more conservative council. Perhaps in consequence of the payment for attendance, the level of intelligence in the assembly seems to have fallen in the 4th century, though our authorities for this are prejudiced reactionaries like Aristophanes and Plato. Isocrates thought that the assembly should be paid by Athens's enemies to meet frequently since it made so many mistakes. These mistakes cost Athens both her empire and her freedom. The same lust for wealth and power that had undermined the first confederacy now wrecked the second. After the fall of Sparta at Leuctra, Athens felt that it might again expand. In organizing the new empire, she had pledged herself not to permit the appropriation of land outside of Attica by Athenian subjects. Now she conquered Samos, the Thracian Chersonese, and the cities of Pydna, Potidaea, and Methone on the coasts of Macedonia and Thrace, and colonized them with Athenian citizens. The allied states protested, and many of them withdrew from the confederation. Methods of coercion and punishment that had been used and had failed in the 5th century were used and failed again. In 357, Chios, Kos, Rhodes, and Byzantium declared a social war of rebellion, when two of Athens's ablest generals, Timotheus and Iphicrates, judged it unwise to give battle in a storm to the rebel fleet in the Hellespont. The assembly indicted them for cowardice. Timotheus was fined the impossible sum of 100 talents, or $600,000, and fled. Iphicrates was acquitted but never served Athens again. The rebels fought off all attempts to subdue them, and in 355 Athens signed a peace acknowledging their independence. The great city was left without allies, without leaders, without funds, and without friends. Possibly subtler factors entered into the weakening of Athens. The life of thought endangers every civilization that it adorns. In the earlier stages of a nation's history, there is little thought. Action flourishes. Men are direct, uninhibited, frankly pugnacious, and sexual. As civilization develops, as customs, institutions, laws, and morals more and more restrict the operation of natural impulses, action gives way to thought, achievement to imagination, directness to subtlety, expression to concealment, cruelty to sympathy, belief to doubt. The unity of character common to animals and primitive men passes away. Behavior becomes fragmentary and hesitant, conscious and calculating. The willingness to fight subsides into a disposition to infinite argument. Few nations have been able to reach intellectual refinement and aesthetic sensitivity without sacrificing so much in virility and unity that their wealth presents an irresistible temptation to impecunious barbarians. Around every Rome hover the Gauls, around every Athens, some Macedon. 4. The rise of Syracuse. Despite a full measure of political turbulence, Syracuse, throughout the 4th century, was one of the richest and most powerful cities in Greece. Dionysius I, unscrupulous, treacherous, and vain, was the most capable administrator of his time. By turning the island of Ortygia into a fortress residence for himself and walling in the causeway that bound it with the mainland, he had rendered his position almost immune to attack. And by doubling the pay of his soldiers and leading them to easy victories, he secured from them a personal loyalty that kept him on the throne for 38 years. Having established his government, he changed his early policy of severity to one of conciliatory mildness and a kind of egalitarian despotism. He gave choice tracts of land to his officers and his friends, and as a military measure, assigned nearly all the residences on Ortygia and the causeway to his soldiers. All the remaining soil of Syracuse and its environs he distributed equally among the population, free and slave. Under his guidance, Syracuse flourished, though he taxed the people almost as severely as the assembly taxed the Athenians. When the women became too ornate, Dionysius announced that Demeter had appeared to him in a dream and bidden him order all feminine jewelry to be deposited in her temple. He obeyed the goddess, and the women, for the most part, obeyed him. Soon afterward, he borrowed the jewelry from Demeter to finance his campaigns. For at the bottom of all his plans lay the resolve to expel the Carthaginians from Sicily. Envious of Hannibal's resort to battering machines in the siege of Salinas, Dionysius gathered into his service the best mechanics and engineers of Western Greece and set them to improve the tools of war. These men invented, among many new engines of offense and defense, the catapeltes, or catapult, for throwing heavy stones and similar projectiles. This and other military innovations passed from Sicily to Greece and were taken up by Philip of Macedon. A call was sent out for mercenaries, and the armorers of Syracuse manufactured in unheard-of quantities weapons and shields to fit the habits and skills of each group of soldiers engaged. Land battles among the Greeks had heretofore been fought by infantry. Dionysius organized a large body of cavalry, and here too gave hints to Philip and Alexander. At the same time, he poured funds into the building of 200 ships, mostly quadriremes or quinquiremes. In speed and power, this was such an armada as Greece had never seen. A bireme was a galley with two banks or decks of oars. A trireme, quadrireme, or quinquireme probably had not three, four, or five banks of oars, but so many men on each bench, handling so many oars through one oarlock or port. By 397, all was ready, and Dionysius sent an embassy to Carthage to demand the liberation of all Greek cities in Sicily from Carthaginian rule. Anticipating a refusal, he invited these cities to expel their foreign governments. They did. And still enraged by the memory of Hannibal's massacres, they put to death, with tortures seldom used by Greeks, all Carthaginians who fell into their hands. Dionysius did his best to stop the carnage, hoping to sell the captives as slaves. Carthage ferried over a vast army under Himilcon, and war went on at intervals in 397, 392, 383, and 368. In the end, Carthage recovered all that Dionysius had won from her, and after the bloodshed, matters stood as before. Whether through lust for power or feeling that only a united Sicily could end Carthaginian rule, Dionysius had meanwhile turned his arms against the Greek cities in the island. Having subjugated them, he crossed over into Italy, conquered Rhegium, and mastered all southwest Italy. He attacked Etruria and took 1,000 talents from its temple at Agylla. He planned to plunder the shrine of Apollo at Delphi, but time did not permit. Greece mourned that in the same year, 387, liberty had fallen in the west, and in the east had been sold to Persia by the king's peace. 3 years before, Brennus and the Gauls had stood in triumph at the gates of Rome. Everywhere, the barbarians on the fringe of the Greek world were growing stronger, and the ravages of Dionysius in southern Italy paved the way for the conquest of its Greek settlements first by the surrounding natives and then by the half-barbarous Romans. At the next Olympic Games, the orator Lysias called upon Greece to denounce the new tyrant. The multitude attacked the tents of Dionysius's embassy and refused to hear his poetry. The same despot who, after capturing Regium, offered freedom to its inhabitants if they would bring him nearly all their hoarded wealth as ransom, and then, when the wealth had been surrendered, sold them as slaves, was a man of wide culture, not prouder of his sword than of his pen. When the poet Philoxenus, asked by the dictator for his opinion of the royal verses, pronounced them worthless, Dionysius sentenced him to the quarries. The next day the king repented, had Philoxenus released, and gave a banquet in his honor. But when Dionysius read more of his poetry, and asked Philoxenus to judge it, Philoxenus bade the attendants take him back to the quarries. Despite such discouragements, Dionysius patronized literature and the arts, and was pleased for a moment to entertain Plato, who was then, in 387, traveling in Sicily. According to a widespread tradition reported by Diogenes Laertius, the philosopher condemned dictatorship. "Your words," said Dionysius, "are those of an old dotard." "Your language," said Plato, "is that of a tyrant." Dionysius, we are told, sold him into slavery, but the philosopher was soon ransomed by Onesicrus of Cyrene. The dictator's life was ended not by any of the assassins whom he feared, but by his own poetry. In 367, his tragedy, The Ransom of Hector, received first prize at the Athenian Linnaea. Dionysius was so pleased that he feasted with his friends, drank much wine, fell into a fever, and died. The harassed city, which had borne with him as an alternative to subjection by Carthage, accepted hopefully the succession of his son to the throne. Dionysius II was now a youth of 25, weak in body and mind, and therefore, thought the crafty Syracusans, likely to give them a mild and negligent rule. He had able advisers in Dion, his uncle, and Philistius the historian. Dion was a man of wealth, but also a lover of letters and philosophy, and a devoted disciple of Plato. He became a member of the academy and lived, at home and abroad, a life of philosophical simplicity. It occurred to him that the malleable youth of the new dictator offered an opportunity of establishing, if not quite the utopia that Plato had described to him, at least a constitutional regime capable of uniting all Sicily for the expulsion of the Carthaginian power. At Dion's suggestion, Dionysius II invited Plato to his court and submitted himself to Plato's tutoring. Doubtless the young autocrat put his best foot forward and concealed from his teacher that addiction to drink and lechery which had drawn from his father the prediction that the dynasty would die with his son. Deceived by the youth's apparent willingness, Plato led him towards philosophy by its most difficult approaches, mathematics and virtue. The ruler was told, as Confucius had told the Duke of Lu, that the first principle of government is good example, that to improve his people he must make himself a model of intelligence and goodwill. All the court began to study geometry and to stand in diplomatic awe over figures traced in the sand. But Philistius, eclipsed by Plato's ascendancy, whispered to the dictator that all this was merely a plot by which the Athenians, who had failed to conquer Syracuse with an army and a fleet, would capture it through a single man, and that Plato, having taken the impregnable citadel with diagrams and dialogues, would depose Dionysius and put Dion on the throne. Dionysius saw in these whispers an excellent escape from geometry. He banished Dion, confiscated his property, and gave Dion's wife to a courtier whom she feared. Despite the dictator's protestations of affection, Plato left Syracuse and joined Dion in Athens. 6 years later, he returned at the king's invitation and pled for Dion's recall. Dionysius refused, and Plato resigned himself to the academy. In 357, Dion, poor in funds but rich in friends, recruited in mainland Greece a force of 800 men and sailed for Syracuse. Landing secretly, he found the people eager to aid him. With one battle, in which, though he was now 50, his own heroic fighting turned the tide, he so completely defeated the army of Dionysius that the frightened youth fled to Italy. At this juncture, with Greek impulsiveness, the Syracusan assembly that he had convened removed Dion from command, lest he should make himself dictator. Dion withdrew peaceably to Leontini, but the forces of Dionysius, liking this turn of events, made a sudden attack upon the popular army and defeated it. The leaders who had deposed him sent appeals to Dion to hurry back and take charge. He came, won another victory, forgave the men who had opposed him, and then announced a temporary dictatorship as necessary to order. Despite the advice of his friends, he refused a personal guard, being quite ready to die, he said, rather than live perpetually on the watch against friends and foes alike. Instead, he maintained, amid surroundings of wealth and power, his accustomed modesty of life. For though, says Plutarch, all things had now succeeded to his wish, yet he desired not to enjoy any present advantage of his good fortune. He was content with a very frugal and moderate competency, and was indeed the wonder of all men, that when not only Sicily and Carthage, but all Greece looked to him as in the height of prosperity, and no man living greater than he, no general more renowned for valor and success, yet in his guard, his attendants, his table, he seemed as if he rather communed with Plato in the academy than lived among hired captains and paid soldiers, whose solace of their toils and dangers it is to eat and drink their fill and enjoy themselves plentifully every day. If we may credit Plato, it was Dion's aim to establish a constitutional monarchy, to reform Syracuse in life and manners on the Spartan model, to rebuild and unify the enslaved or desolate Greek cities of Sicily, and then to expel the Carthaginians from the island. But the Syracusans had set their hearts on democracy, and were no more hungry for virtue than either Dionysius. A friend of Dion murdered him, and chaos broke loose. Dionysius hurried home, recaptured Ortygia and the government, and ruled with the bitter cruelty of a despot deposed and restored. Undeserved fates come sometimes to individuals, but rarely to nations. The Syracusans appealed for aid to their mother city, Corinth. The call came at a time when a Corinthian of almost legendary nobleness was waiting for a summons to heroism. Timoleon was an aristocrat who so loved liberty that when his brother Timophanes tried to make himself tyrant of Corinth, Timoleon killed him. Cursed by his mother and brooding over his deed, the tyrannicide withdrew to a woodland retreat, shunning all men. Hearing nevertheless of Syracuse's need, he came out of his retirement, organized a small force of volunteers, sailed to Sicily, and deployed his little band with such strategy that the royal army yielded after a brief taste of his generalship, and without killing any one of his men. Timoleon gave the humbled tyrant money enough to take himself to Corinth, where Dionysius spent the remainder of his life teaching school and sometimes begging his bread. Timoleon re-established democracy, tore down the fortifications that had made Ortygia a buttress of tyranny, repulsed the Carthaginian invasion, restored freedom and democracy in the Greek cities, and made Sicily for a generation so peaceful and prosperous that new settlers were drawn to it from every part of the Hellenic world. Then, refusing public office, he retired to private life. But the island democracies, appreciating his wisdom and integrity, submitted all major matters to his judgment and freely followed his advice. Two sycophants, having indicted him on a charge of malfeasance, he insisted over the protests of a grateful people on being tried without favor according to the laws, and thanked the gods that freedom of speech and equality before the law had been restored in Sicily. When he died, in 337, all Greece looked upon him as one of the greatest of her sons. 5. The Advance of Macedonia. While Timoleon was restoring democracy for its last respite in ancient Sicily, Philip was destroying it on the mainland. Macedonia, despite the cultural hospitality of Archelaus, was still for the most part a barbarous country of hardy but letterless mountaineers when Philip came to the throne in 359. Indeed, to the end of its career, though it used Greek as its official language, it contributed no author or artist or scientist or philosopher to the life of Greece. Having lived for 3 years with the relatives of Epaminondas in Thebes, Philip had imbibed there a modicum of culture and a wealth of military ideas. He had all the virtues except those of civilization. He was strong in body and will, athletic and handsome, a magnificent animal trying now and then to be an Athenian gentleman. Like his famous son, he was a man of violent temper and abounding generosity, loving battle as much and strong drink more. Unlike Alexander, he was a jovial laugher and raised to high office a slave who amused him. He liked boys but liked women better and married as many of them as he could. For a time, he tried monogamy with Olympias, the wild and beautiful Molossian princess who gave him Alexander. But his fancy later traveled, and Olympias brooded over her revenge. Most of all, he liked stalwart men, who could risk their lives all day and gamble and carouse with him half the night. He was literally, before Alexander, the bravest of the brave, and left a part of himself on every battlefield. "What a man!" exclaimed his greatest enemy, Demosthenes. "For the sake of power and dominion, he had an eye struck out, a shoulder broken, an arm and a leg paralyzed." He had a subtle intelligence, capable of patiently awaiting his chance, and of moving resolutely through difficult means to distant ends. In diplomacy, he was affable and treacherous. He broke a promise with a light heart and was always ready to make another. He recognized no morals for governments and looked upon lies and bribes as humane substitutes for slaughter. But he was lenient in victory and usually gave the defeated Greeks better terms than they gave one another. All who met him, except the obstinate Demosthenes, liked him and ranked him as the strongest and most interesting character of his time. His government was an aristocratic monarchy in which the king's powers were limited by the duration of his superior strength of arm or mind, and by the willingness of the nobles to support him. 800 feudal barons made up the king's companions. They were great landowners who despised the life of cities, crowds, and books. But when, with their consent, the king announced a war, they came out of their estates physically fit and drunkenly brave. In the army they served as cavalry, riding the sturdy horses of Macedonia and Thrace, and trained by Philip to fight in a close formation that could change its tactics at once and as one at commander's word. Beside these was an infantry of rugged hunters and peasants arrayed in phalanxes, 16 rows of men pointing their lances over the heads or resting them on the shoulders of the rows ahead of them, making each phalanx an iron wall. The lance, 21 feet long, was weighted at the rear, so that when held aloft it projected 15 feet forward. As each row of soldiers marched 3 feet before the next, the lances of the first 5 rows projected beyond the phalanx, and the lances of the first 3 rows had a greater reach than the 6-foot javelin of the nearest Greek hoplite. The Macedonian soldier, after hurling his lance, fought with a short sword, and protected himself with a brass helmet, a coat of mail, greaves, and a lightweight shield. Behind the phalanx came a regiment of old-fashioned archers who shot their arrows over the heads of the lancers. Then came a siege train with catapults and battering rams. Resolutely and patiently, playing Frederick William I to Alexander's Frederick, Philip drilled this army of 10,000 men into the most powerful fighting instrument that Europe had yet known. With this force he was determined to unify Greece under his leadership. Then, with the help of all Hellas, he proposed to cross the Hellespont and drive the Persians out of Greek Asia. At every step toward this end he found himself running counter to the Hellenic love of freedom. And in trying to overcome this resistance he almost forgot the end in the means. His first move brought him into conflict with Athens, for he sought to win possession of the cities that Athens had acquired on the Macedonian and Thracian coasts. These cities not only blocked his way to Asia, they also controlled rich gold mines and a taxable trade. While Athens was absorbed in the social war that ended her second empire, Philip seized Amphipolis in 357, Pydna, and Potidaea in 356, and answered the protests of Athens with fine compliments to Athenian literature and art. In 355 he took Methone, losing an eye in the siege. In 347, after a long campaign of chicanery and bravery, he captured Olynthus. He now controlled all the European coast of the North Aegean, had an income of 1,000 talents a year from the mines of Thrace, and could turn his thoughts to winning the support of Greece. To finance his campaigns, he had sold thousands of captives, many of them Athenians, into slavery, and had lost the goodwill of Hellenes. It was fortunate for him that during these years the Greek states were exhausting themselves in a second sacred war, from 356 to 346, over the spoliation of the Delphic treasury by the Phocians. The Spartans and Athenians fought for the Phocians, the Amphictyonic League, Boeotia, Locris, Doris, Thessaly, fought against them. Losing, the Amphictyonic council besought the help of Philip. He saw his opportunity, came swiftly down through the open passes, overwhelmed the Phocians in 346, was received into the Delphic Amphictyony, was acclaimed as the protector of the shrine, and accepted an invitation to preside over all the Greeks at the Pythian Games. He cast his eyes upon the divided states of the Peloponnesus, and felt that he could win all of them except weakened Sparta to accept him as leader in a Greek confederacy that might free all Greeks in the east and the west. But Athens, listening at last to Demosthenes, saw in Philip not a liberator but an enslaver, and decided to fight for the jealous sovereignty of the city-state, and the preservation of that free democracy which had made her the light of the world. 6. Demosthenes. The Vatican statue of the great orator is one of the masterpieces of Hellenistic realism. It is a careworn face, as if every advance of Philip had cut another furrow into the brow. The body is thin and wearied. The aspect is that of a man who is about to make a final appeal for a cause that he considers lost. The eyes reveal a restless life and foresee a bitter death. His father was a manufacturer of swords and bed frames who bequeathed to him a business worth some 14 talents, or $84,000. 3 executors administered the property for the boy and squandered it so generously on themselves that when Demosthenes reached the age of 20 in 363, He had to sue his guardians to recover the remains of his inheritance. He spent most of this in fitting out a trireme for the Athenian navy, and then settled down to earn his bread by writing speeches for litigants. He could compose better than he could speak, for he was weak in body and defective in articulation. Sometimes, says Plutarch, he prepared pleas for both the opposed parties to a dispute. Meanwhile, to overcome his impediments, he addressed the sea with a mouthful of pebbles, or declaimed as he ran up a hill. He worked hard, and his only distractions were courtesans and boys. What can one do with Demosthenes? His secretary complained. Everything that he has thought of for a whole year is thrown into confusion by one woman in one night. After years of effort, he became one of the richest lawyers at the Athenian bar, learned in technicalities, convincing in discourse, and flexible in morals. He defended the banker Phormio against precisely such charges as he had brought against his guardians, took substantial fees from private persons for introducing and pressing legislation, and never answered the accusation of his colleague Hyperides that he was receiving money from the Persian king to stir up war against Philip. At his zenith, his fortune was 10 times as large as that which his father had left him. Nevertheless, he had the integrity to suffer and die for the views that he was paid to defend. He denounced the dependence of Athens upon mercenary troops, and insisted that the citizens who received money from the Theoric Fund should earn it by serving in the army. His courage rose to the point of demanding that this fund should be used not to pay citizens to attend religious ceremonies and plays, but to organize a better force for the defense of the state. He told the Athenians that they were degenerate slackers who had lost the military virtues of their progenitors. He refused to admit that the city-state had stultified itself with faction and war, and that the times called for the unity of Greece. This unity, he warned, was a phrase to conceal the subjugation of Greece to one man. He detected the ambitions of Philip from their first symptoms, and begged the Athenians to fight to retain their allies and colonies in the north. Against Demosthenes and Hyperides and the party of war stood Aeschines and Phocion in the party of peace. Very likely both sides were bribed, the one by Persia, the other by Philip, and both were sincerely moved by their own agitation. Phocion was by common consent the most honest statesman of his time, a Stoic before Zeno, a philosophical product of Plato's academy, an orator who so despised the assembly that when it applauded him he asked a friend, "Have I not unconsciously said something bad?" 45 times he was chosen strategos, far surpassing the record of Pericles. He served ably as a general in many wars, but spent most of his life in advocating peace. His associate Aeschines was no Stoic, but a man who had risen from bitter poverty to a comfortable income. His youth as a teacher and an actor helped him to become a fluent speaker, the first Greek orator, we are told, to speak extempore with success. His rivals wrote out their speeches in advance. Having served with Phocion in several engagements, he adopted Phocion's policy of compromising with Philip instead of making war, and when Philip paid him for his efforts, his enthusiasm for peace became an edifying devotion. Twice Demosthenes indicted Aeschines on the charge of receiving Macedonian gold, and twice failed to convict him. Finally, however, the martial eloquence of Demosthenes and the southward advance of Philip persuaded the Athenians to forego for a time the distribution of the Theoric Fund and to employ it in war. In 338, an army was hastily organized and marched north to face the phalanxes of Philip at Boeotian Chaeronea. Sparta refused to help, but Thebes, feeling Philip's fingers at her throat, sent her sacred band to fight beside the Athenians. Every one of its 300 members died on that battlefield. The Athenians fought almost as bravely, but they had waited too long, and were not equipped to meet so novel an army as the Macedonian. They broke and fled before the sea of lances that moved upon them, and Demosthenes fled with them. Alexander, Philip's 18-year-old son, led the Macedonian cavalry with reckless courage and won the honors of a bitter day. Philip was diplomatically generous in victory. He put to death some of the anti-Macedonian leaders in Thebes and set up his partisans there in oligarchic power. But he freed the 2,000 Athenian prisoners that he had taken, and sent the charming Alexander and the judicious Antipater to offer peace on condition that Athens recognize him as the general of all Greece against the common foe. Athens, which had expected harsher terms, not only consented, but passed resolutions showering compliments upon the new Agamemnon. Philip convened at Corinth a synedrion, or assembly of the Greek states, formed them, except Sparta, into a federation modeled on the Boeotian, and outlined his plans for the liberation of Asia. He was unanimously chosen commander in this enterprise. Each state pledged him men and arms and promised that no Greek anywhere should fight against him. Such sacrifices were a small price to pay for his distance. The results of Chaeronea were endless. The unity that Greece had failed to create for itself had been achieved, but only at the point of a half-alien sword. The Peloponnesian War had proved Athens capable of organizing Hellas, the aftermath had shown Sparta incapable, the Theban hegemony in its turn had failed. The wars of the armies and the classes had worn out the city-states and left them too weak for defense. Under the circumstances, they were fortunate to find so reasonable a conqueror, who proposed to withdraw from the scene of his victory and leave to the conquered a large measure of freedom. Indeed, Philip and Alexander after him watchfully protected the autonomy of the federated states, lest any one of them, by absorbing others, should grow strong enough to displace Macedon. One great liberty, however, Philip took away, the right of revolution. He was a frank conservative who considered the stability of property an indispensable stimulus to enterprise and a necessary prop to government. He persuaded the synod at Corinth to insert into the Articles of Federation a pledge against any change of constitution, any social transformation, any political reprisals. In each state he lent his influence to the side of property and put an end to confiscatory taxation. He had laid his plans well, except for Olympias. In the end, his fate was determined not by his victories in the field, but by his failure with his wife. She frightened him not only by her temper, but by participating in the wildest Dionysian rites. One night he found a snake lying beside her in bed and was not reassured by being told that it was a god. Worse, Olympias informed him that he was not the real father of Alexander, that on the night of their wedding a thunderbolt had fallen upon her and set her afire. It was the great god Zeus Ammon who had begotten the dashing prince. Discouraged by such varied competition, Philip turned his amours to other women, and Olympias began her revenge by telling Alexander the secret of his divine paternity. One of Philip's generals, Attalus, made matters worse by proposing a toast to Philip's expected child by a second wife, as promising a legitimate, that is, completely Macedonian, heir to the throne. Alexander flung a goblet at his head, crying, "Am I then a bastard?" Philip drew his sword against his son, but was so drunk that he could not stand. Alexander laughed at him. "Here," he said, "is a man preparing to cross from Europe into Asia who cannot step surely from one couch to another." A few months later, one of Philip's officers, Pausanias, having asked redress from Philip for an insult from Attalus and receiving no satisfaction, assassinated the king in 336. Alexander, idolized by the army and supported by Olympias, seized the throne, overcame all opposition, and prepared to conquer the world. Chapter 20. Letters and Arts in the 4th Century. 1. The Orators. Through all this turmoil, literature reflected the declining virility of Greece. Lyrical poetry was no longer the passionate expression of creative individuals, but a polite exercise of salon intellectuals, a learned echo of school-day tasks. Timotheus of Miletus wrote an epic, but it did not accord with an argumentative age and remained as unpopular as his early music. Dramatic performances continued, but on a more modest scale and in a lower key. The impoverishment of the public treasury and the weakened patriotism of private wealth reduced the splendor and significance of the chorus. More and more, the dramatists contented themselves with unrelated musical intermezzi in place of choruses organically united with the play. The name of the choragus disappeared from public notice, then the name of the poet. Only the name of the actor remained. The drama became less and less a poem, more and more a histrionic exhibition. It was an era of great actors and small dramatists. Greek tragedy had been built upon religion and mythology and required some faith and piety in its auditors. It naturally faded away in the twilight of the gods. Comedy prospered as tragedy decayed and took over something of the subtlety, refinement, and subject matter of the Euripidean stage. This middle comedy, from 400 to 323, lost its taste or courage for political satire precisely when politics most needed a candid friend. Possibly such satire was forbidden, or the audience was weary of politics now that Athens was ruled by second-rate men. The general retirement of the 4th-century Greek from public to private life inclined his interest from affairs of state to those of the home and the heart. The comedy of manners appeared. Love began to dominate the scene, and not always by its virtue. The ladies of the demimonde mingled on the boards with fishwives, cooks, and bewildered philosophers, though the honor of the protagonists and the dramatists was saved by a marriage at the end. These plays were not coarsened by Aristophanes' vulgarity and burlesque, but neither were they vitalized by his exuberance and his imagination. We know the names and have none of the works of 39 poets of the Middle Comedy, but we may judge from their fragments that they did not write for the ages. Alexis of Thurii wrote 245 plays, and Tiffany's 260. They made hay while the sun shone and died with its setting. It was a century of orators. The rise of industry and trade turned men's minds to realism and practicality, and the schools that once had taught the poems of Homer now trained their pupils in rhetoric. Isaeus, Lycurgus, Hyperides, Demades, Dinarchus, Aeschines, Demosthenes were orator politicians, leaders of political factions, masters of what the Germans have called the Advokatenrepublik. Similar men appeared in the democratic interludes of Syracuse. The oligarchic states did not suffer them. The Athenian orators were clear and vigorous in language, averse to ornate eloquence, capable now and then of noble patriotic flights, and given to such dishonesty of argument and abusiveness of speech as would not be tolerated even in a modern campaign. The heterogeneous quality of the Athenian assembly and the popular courts had a debasing as well as a stimulating effect upon Greek oratory, and through it upon Greek literature. The Athenian citizen enjoyed bouts of oratorical invective almost as much as he enjoyed a prize fight. When a duel was expected between such word warriors as Aeschines and Demosthenes, men came from distant villages and foreign states to hear them. Often the appeal was to pride and prejudice. Plato, who hated oratory as the poison that was killing democracy, defined rhetoric as the art of governing men by addressing their feelings and passions. Even Demosthenes, with all his vigor and nervous intensity, his frequent assent to passages of patriotic fervor, his withering fire of personal attack, his clever and relieving alternation of narrative and argument, the carefully rhythmic quality of his language, and the overwhelming torrent of his speech. Even Demosthenes strikes us as a little less than great. He laid the secret of oratory in acting, hypocrisis, and so believed this that he rehearsed his speeches patiently and recited them before a mirror. He dug himself a cave and lived in it for months, practicing secretly. In these periods he kept one half of his face shaved to deter himself from leaving his retreat. On the rostrum he contorted his figure, whirled round and round, laid his hand upon his forehead as in reflection, and often raised his voice to a scream. All this, says Plutarch, was wonderfully pleasing to the common people, but by well-educated persons, as for example by Demetrius of Phalerum, it was looked upon as mean, humiliating, and unmanly. We are amused by Demosthenes's histrionics, amazed by his self-esteem, confused by his digressions, and appalled by his ungracious scurrility. There is little wit in him, little philosophy. Only his patriotism redeems him, and the apparent sincerity of his despairing cry for freedom. The historic climax of Greek oratory came in 330. 6 years before, Ctesiphon had carried through the council a preliminary proposal to award Demosthenes a crown or wreath in appreciation not only of his statesmanship, but of his many financial gifts to the state. To keep this honor from his rival, Aeschines indicted Ctesiphon on the ground, technically correct, of having introduced an unconstitutional proposal. The case of Ctesiphon, repeatedly postponed, finally came to trial before a jury of 500 citizens. It was, of course, a cause celebre. All who could came, even from afar, to hear it. For in effect, the greatest of Athenian orators was fighting for his good name and his political life. Aeschines spent little time attacking Ctesiphon, but turned his assault upon the character and career of Demosthenes, who replied in kind with his famous speech on the crown. Every line of the two orations still vibrates with excitement and is hot with the hatred of enemies brought face to face in war. Demosthenes, knowing that offense is better than defense, charged that Philip had chosen the most corruptible of the orators as his mouthpieces in Athens. Then he etched in acid a life portrait of Aeschines.